So what is resonance and where does it come from? Well, resonance is a way for valence bond theory, which says that bonds are the overlap of atomic orbitals or bonding orbitals, and the bond exists between the atoms. It's a way for valence bond theory to explain a phenomenon in bonding that is a construct of MO theory. Molecular orbital theory says that bonding orbitals are shared throughout the entire molecule, not just the area between the two atoms. And so molecular orbital theory can explain delocalization of electrons very easily, whereas valence bond theory cannot. But with valence bond theory, where we derive our Lewis and Kekulé structures from, we use resonance to approximate what molecular orbital theory would tell us more readily. But we can use our structures that we've already learned to be able to get there. And so there's a few rules for resonance. Atoms don't move, and we must have a continuous line of p orbitals between atoms. So even if they're lone pairs, those lone pairs can be taken into pi bonds, and then pi bonds can be kicked out into lone pairs. And we would say that those are still in p orbitals and a part of the resonance. Sigma bonds don't form or break, and an sp3 atom cannot accept a pair of electrons. For example, if we had this compound, we could not send electrons toward an sp3 atom. Okay, and so let's look at four types of resonance. The first being cationic resonance. And with cationic resonance, we have a couple of rules, but the first thing we want to say is that we have one arrow per resonance contributor. If you use one arrow, you're going to find every resonance contributor. If you use more than one, you're going to miss one. And so let's look at what that looks like. So I'm going to take a pi bond and actually form another pi bond from this. And so we have our continuous line of p orbitals here, carbocations or sp2 hybridized in this example, and then sp2 for all the double bond carbons as well. And so let's look at our next contributor. A lot of places will not recommend the use of arrows for this movement, because there really isn't an electron movement. None of these contributors are actually there. Okay? And we can move again one arrow per contributor, form the pi bond. What is actually there is the resonance hybrid. And so now that we're at the end of the line, we can't go any further. We can draw the resonance hybrid. No atom moves. But there is a double bond, a partial double bond, indicated anywhere that a double bond existed for part of the time in any one of our contributors. It would be a solid double bond if it didn't move, but here they all moved, and we put a delta to indicate a positive charge, a partial positive charge, anywhere a contributor had a partial charge, or a full charge, and any one of the contributors gives a partial positive. And so the resonance hybrid looks like this, and molecular orbital theory would predict that this is the structure, the hybrid is the structure, and none of the three contributors exist, but we can derive the hybrid from the three contributing structures. What about anionic resonance? Well, we're going to have two arrows per contributor. Remember, these aren't indicating electron movement. What we're indicating is a way to find all the contributors. Atoms don't move, so I can go ahead and just draw in the atoms, and then two arrows, we said. Form the pi bond from the lone pair, and then kick up the pi bond to a lone pair. for anionic. We want to catch them all. We do that. One double bond doesn't change. We form a lone pair and form a pi bond. Then we go again. Two arrows form a pi bond, make a lone pair. On to the carbon. The arrow points directly to the carbon. Formed a pi bond, formed a lone pair. So now we're ready for the hybrid again. And that hybrid structure partial double bond, anywhere a double bond exists in a contributor, partial negative for anywhere there was a partial negative or a full negative charge in any one contributor. So the hybrid looks like this. Neutral resonance, a little bit different. I like to say we go all the way both ways. And so what does that mean? That means if we're going to have a neutral compound, let's send these bonds as far as we can, and then at the end we kick up a lone pair. What did we also do? We also formed a cation here, and there's the anion we just predicted. Cation here, and then the double bond forms there. And so that's not a good thing. We just went from zero charge to a plus and a minus in the same compound. So charge separation's bad, not the best. But here's why we say go all the way both ways. I'm going to turn around, go back to my original compound, and go the other way. And when I do, I form the exact opposite effect. I send the plus to where the minus was and the minus to where the plus was. So what that does in the hybrid, what is actually there is not a separation of charges. What is actually there is a delocalization of electrons throughout the entire pi system. And there's no partial charges because minuses cancel out pluses and pluses minuses on either end. So we end up with just the partial delocalization of the pi bonds for neutral resonance. We don't want to generate charge separation if we can help it. Okay, last type of resonance we're going to look at here is radical. And we're going to have three half arrows, fishhook arrows, per contributor. So we don't miss anything. We do that. Meet in the middle. Form a new pi bond, one radical left over. Atoms don't move. That pi bond wasn't involved. There's our radical. We form the pi bond here. Three arrows per contributor. Three half arrows meet in the middle. One left over again. And so we're at the end of the line. Our hybrid structure is going to look like this, with a partial radical everywhere we had a radical and a contributor. So the hybrid's what's actually there.